We exalt you, Lord, for you are high and lifted up, and there is nobody like unto my God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen, amen. I think it's just possible we might have some church in here tonight. Is that all right? Amen. I mean, we all went to the trouble of getting ready and coming. We might as well let God do something. Amen? Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. It truly is an honor and a privilege to be here. When I told my brother and my father that we were going to have the chance to be here, they said to make sure to greet your pastor and to greet this church and this congregation. So greetings from my parents and from my brother and his family. Amen. Glory. Amen. As your pastor said, we have been appointed as missionaries to the Czech Republic. If you don't know where that is, to kind of give you a little bit of a mental image of where that is, we're just east of Germany, south of Poland, north of Austria, and west of Russia and the Ukraine. Okay? In other words, we're right smack dab in the middle of Europe. And being right smack dab in the middle of Europe, that's a good place for revival to break out. Because when you're right smack dab in the middle of something and revival breaks out, it spreads everywhere. And we're looking forward to the revival fires of the Holy Ghost spreading all throughout Europe and just seeing what God can do. Amen. The nation of the Czech Republic is a nation of around 10 million people. That's a whole lot of people. The capital city where we will be residing, the city of Prague, is a city of 1.2 million people. In that entire nation, we have one church in the capital city of Prague. We have one licensed minister for that entire nation. The one church with the one licensed minister has an average attendance of around 20 to 25 people. What that tells me is we've got a really big job in front of us. Thankfully, we serve a really big God. Amen. But you know, reaching a nation of 10 million people, that didn't seem to be challenge enough. So when I was doing some of my research and study, I came across some numbers that were startling. From some of the most recent numbers I have, some of the most recent statistics tell us that in the capital city of Prague, over 80% of the population claims atheism as their religion. So my question is this: how do you go into a nation where the majority of the people, four out of the four people, don't even believe that God exists? How do you go into that place and preach the gospel? What do you do? My only solution and my only answer is this. We're going to go in and declare with a loud voice, there is a God. And if you will let him, that God can and will change your life. Amen. He's able. He is able. Amen. We're so excited to be able to go. I'm so glad that my family is with me. They don't get to travel with me all of the time. As a matter of fact, I'll be driving tomorrow to drop them off for the next couple of months with Grandma and Grandpa. Grandma and Grandpa said they need their time with the grandkids before I take them overseas. But I'm glad they're with me tonight, and I want to introduce them. This is Grant. He is 3 years old, almost four. Almost four is very important. And Pierce turned one last week. And then my wife, Sister Buckland. I married up, so I like to show her off. So I'm glad that she's with us. I'd like her to greet you this evening.
So nice to be here with all of you this evening. Sorry, there's a fan or something that's attacking me. Okay, it's nice to be here with all of you this evening. I want to take this opportunity to thank you for some of the offerings you give as a local church that mean a lot to us as missionaries. Mother's Memorial offering helps us by providing us with appliances while we're overseas. So for that, we're very appreciative. And She's for Christ offering provides us with a vehicle so that we can travel around the Czech Republic, and we appreciate that as well. And we're looking forward to what God has in store tonight.
Thank you.
Amen. And I'm so glad that they get to be with us. The Czech Republic is a beautiful place. All right. Amen. The Czech Republic is a very beautiful place. We have a table set up in the back, and there's a lot of pictures and things like that. As you look through those pictures, you will see a number of pictures of castles and cathedrals. There are more castles per square mile in the Czech Republic than any nation in the world. You walk downtown in the capital city of Prague, it's almost like walking in Disneyland, but it's all real. It's not facades. Almost every corner is a castle or a cathedral, and you're walking on cobblestones. It feels like you've gone back 500 years in time. And it's a beautiful, beautiful place, but it's a place in need of God. Amen. We're thankful for everything that you do to help missionaries and to support missionaries. I will say, we are doing the very best we can to keep our PIM budget as low as we can. That's the budget that helps. That's our monthly support base that gets us over into our nation of calling. In order to do that, there's a number of one-time expenses that we have. Instead of incorporating that into our monthly budget, headquarters has given us permission to raise one-time offerings for that. So if you would like to help right now, we are working on an airfare project. I've decided I don't want to swim to Europe. So we're raising money for airfare. If you would like to help with that, there's a basket on the table back there in the back, and any change or anything you drop in there, that goes directly to our account at headquarters and goes towards our airfare budget, so they don't have to incorporate those costs and expenses into our PIM budget. I said coins. We accept bills and checks and all that stuff too. It all works. So, and also your church will get credit as a missions offering for anything that goes into that basket. So we will say thank you for that as well. Amen. Well, we're at church, right? I just thought I would check. We've talked about where we're going and the job that's in front of us, but maybe I'm crazy. I feel like when we come to church, we ought to hear some preaching and ought to just let God do something great. Is that okay? Amen. And I know when you've got a guest speaker, I've been sitting where you're sitting, you don't know what to expect. I know these things. So if it's all right, I'll make a deal with you. I was at a crusade a while back, and it was overseas. We had a guest speaker from America, and he got up and got ready to preach. He read his text, and before he began preaching, he kind of talked a little bit. You know how preachers do that sometimes? Well, in the midst of his talking, he said something along the lines of, if you need the Holy Ghost tonight, all you have to do is come up to the front and God will fill you with the Holy Ghost. Well, the people in the congregation believed him. So they just stood up and started coming to the front. Well, the preacher didn't know what to do, so he looked at his translator and said, what do I do? The translator said, well, it's your fault. You're the one that told them they could get the Holy Ghost. So he put down his microphone and just went and started praying with people. And before they left, more than 50 people had been filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. So I'll make a deal with you tonight. If you decide you've heard enough, if you'll just get up and respond, I have no problem stopping at any time. Is that okay? And I don't mind saying that because that happened in the book of Acts. And we purport to be a book of Acts church, is that right? So if the Holy Ghost starts to fall, I have no problem stopping, because nothing that I have to say is so important that I would want to stop a move of the Spirit in this place tonight. I believe that God's going to pour out His Spirit. We're going to see signs and miracles and wonders. We're going to see people filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. We're going to see people delivered. We're going to see people brought out. We're going to see people filled with the Spirit of God, because when God shows up, those things happen. Amen. And I'm just crazy enough to believe that God is going to show up in this place, and God is going to show out in this place tonight, and we're going to see some great things happen. Amen. Amen. If you would stand with me and turn in your Bibles to the book of Exodus chapter number 3. Exodus chapter number 3, and I'm going to begin reading at the 19th verse. Exodus 3, chapter number 3, verse number 19, and it says this. It says, "And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and it shall come to pass that when ye go, ye shall not go empty. But every woman shall borrow of her neighbor and of her that sojourneth in her house, jewels of silver, jewels of gold, and raiment, and ye shall put them upon your sons and upon your daughters, and ye shall spoil the Egyptians." And I want to take my thought from the 21st verse. The end of that verse says this: "When ye go, ye shall not go empty." And I want to preach for a little while tonight on this thought: don't leave empty. Don't leave empty. Amen. Now I've got a favor to ask of you. Before you're seated, would you look at somebody and just smile? You look better when you smile. Amen. We are in the house of God. It's okay to smile in God's house. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. To kind of catch us up to date on what's going on here in the first part of the book of Exodus, the children of Israel have been in Egyptian slavery for right around 400 years. God has spoken to Moses and said, "Moses, I'm going to use you to deliver my people out of the land of Egypt." He said, "But before they leave, there's some very important things that I want you to tell them. And the thing that I want you to tell them most importantly is this, that before they leave, I want them to go and get everything they can out of the land of Egypt. Get their gold, get their silver, get their treasure, get everything that's valuable from the land of Egypt, because I want them to take it with them when they go." So Moses goes down to the land of Egypt and from the backside of the wilderness, and he begins to tell all of this and convey all of this to the children of Israel. Now, as he's telling the children of Israel this, as soon as he says the words, "God said we're getting out of here," I'm sure that's where a lot of the children of Israel stop listening. They hear the words, "We're getting out of here." Their first thought is, "Let's go." Moses goes on to say, "You need to go get all this stuff from the Egyptians." And the children of Israel, I'm sure they're thinking in their mind, "Egypt can keep all of their stuff. A matter of fact, Egypt can keep my stuff. If we can get out of here, let's go." But God was very specific in what he told them. He said, "You need to go get all this stuff from the Egyptians." Now, why would he tell them that? Why? Now, if there's something that I've learned from living on the road on deputational travels, it's this: living on the road is expensive. Pastor, I was just doing some of my reports. Over the last 4 months, I've put 17,000 miles on my vehicle. That's a lot of driving. That's a lot of driving. That's a lot of tanks of gas, oil changes. We live in our minivan, basically. And you know what our minivan does not have? A kitchen. And I have two children who like to eat. And since we don't have a kitchen, anytime they say, "Mom and Dad, I'm hungry," guess what we get to do? Go out to eat. All of that stuff adds up. That's for a family of four. Most Bible historians estimate that there were upwards of 3 million children of Israel when they left the land of Egypt. When we run out of resources, you know what we do? go to the store. Pull off at the next exit. Go through a McDonald's drive-thru. Or stop at one that hopefully has a play place so the kids can burn energy. How many McDonald's do they have in the wilderness? Not very many. I would venture to say, I'll go out on a limb and say there were none. When God told the children of Israel, you're getting out of here, he saw they weren't going directly from Egypt to the promised land. They had 40 years of wilderness wandering in front of them, and God realized anything that they need for the trip, they're going to have to take it with them. So he said, before you leave the land of Egypt, I see what's lying in front of you. You need to go get everything that you can because you're going to need it for the road. Now, as Moses is telling the children of Israel this, notice what God said to do. He told the children of Israel, I'm leaving the responsibility on you. You go to the Egyptians, you ask, and if you go and ask, I will give you favor and you'll get it. By extension, that means if you don't go ask, you're not going to get it. And knowing human nature the way that I do, I would venture to say a significant percentage of the children of Israel did not go and ask. How can I say that? If you read on through the book of Exodus, you find they barely made it out of Egypt and they were ready to stone Moses because they said, we're out of resources. But can you imagine the thought processes and how all of this would have gone with the children of Israel? Moses says, you go to the Egyptians and you ask. And here's the children of Israel knocking on the Egyptian's door and say, hey, Mr. Egyptian taskmaster, it's me, your slave. I was wondering, can I have all of your gold and silver? Would you mind if I had all of your treasure? It's probably not a conversation that regularly took place. Seems like a dangerous conversation to have. And so I can hear these little Hebrew ladies talking amongst themselves as Moses is conveying all of this. And they're saying to themselves, you know, that may work for so-and-so down the road. They've got a nice taskmaster. Moses doesn't know my taskmaster. That's just not going to work. But God left the responsibility on them. He said, if you go and ask, I will give you favor. But you got to go and ask. So as I was reading through this text in Exodus chapter number 3, I got to verse number 22 and there was something that really bothered me. Maybe I've just got a weird mind, but sometimes things just jump out at me and they bother me. And I just couldn't get away from this. I was reading verse number 22. Oh, they got it up there on the screen. That's a good media person. Look at that. Look at how that verse started. It says, but every woman shall borrow of her neighbor. You know what bothered me about that? It was one word. You all caught it right away. Borrow. You know why that word bothered me? It's because what it sounds like God was telling them to do was go and borrow all of this stuff and then skip the country with it. Now that doesn't sound much like borrowing to me. I wouldn't want someone to borrow my stuff in that way. There's another word that jumps into my mind that has nothing to do with borrow. So this really bothered me. It concerned me. So I began to pray about it. I began to study it out. And I believe God gave me a little insight as to what's really taking place here in Exodus chapter number 3. And I think to understand what's really taking place, you really need to jump back into the book of Genesis. In the book of Genesis, you meet a young man by the name of Joseph. And Joseph was a dreamer. He would have these magnificent, fantastic dreams. And as he would have these dreams, God would give him the interpretation. And he would go and he would begin to tell his brothers, man, I had another dream. Guess what? God showed me that one of these days, I'm going to be so important, you are all going to bow down to me. Isn't that great? His brothers weren't too impressed. They got to the point where they were just fed up with Joseph and all of his dreams. They wanted to get rid of him, so they threw him in a pit. They were going to kill him, but right before they killed him, an Ishmaelite slave train came by. And they said, we'll just sell him into slavery. That way his blood isn't on our hands, but he's out of our hair. Well, Joseph ends up in Potiphar's house in the land of Egypt. While he's there, Potiphar's wife falsely accuses him, and he ends up in an Egyptian prison, right? While he's there, he meets two characters, a butler and a baker. They have dreams. He interprets their dreams. The baker ends up being executed. The butler is restored to his position in Pharaoh's house, forgets about Joseph for a while. Pharaoh ends up having some dreams. The butler remembers Joseph, and he goes and he has this conversation with Pharaoh. Now, this is a great way to start a conversation. He goes, Pharaoh, there was this guy I met in prison. Great way to start a conversation. There was this guy I met in prison, and he could interpret dreams. Pharaoh was so frustrated because nobody could interpret his dreams. He says, go find this man and see what he can do. Find Joseph. Joseph gives him the interpretation of the dreams. Pharaoh is so impressed, he makes Joseph second in command in the land of Egypt. God has shown him through Pharaoh's dreams that there's going to be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. God gives Joseph wisdom during the years of famine, and they put back stores during the years of plenty. They put back stores, and during the years of famine, when they come, the famine hits worldwide. People start to come from everywhere to Egypt to get supplies. Because the famine is worldwide, it even hits in Canaan land. Okay? Joseph's family is there. They're about to starve. They hear their supplies in Egypt. They come down to Egypt. Joseph recognizes his brothers. They don't recognize him. He sells them supplies. They go back home, run out of supplies, come back to Egypt the second time. The second time they're there, Joseph reveals himself to his brothers. His brothers are scared to death. They don't know what Joseph is going to do. Joseph makes the phenomenal statement. He says, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. In other words, what he's saying is, God orchestrated this whole thing, even in the darkest times, even in the times when nothing seemed to make sense. God had it all in control and was bringing us to this point because he knew what was happening. Joseph tells his brothers, the famine's going to continue on for a while, but basically, I'm set up here in Egypt. All I have to do is speak the word, and anything that we want is ours. He said, you go back home, you get dad, you get your family, you get your herds, you come back down here, I'm going to set you up in the land of Egypt. Now, I don't imagine Joseph set them up in a lean-to by the side of the road. He's rich and powerful. The Bible tells us that Joseph set up his brothers in Goshen land. That was a fertile part of Egypt. That's important in an agricultural society. That's where crops grow. Herds can be fed and all that stuff. Okay? At the end of the book of Genesis, that's where we leave the children of Israel. They're rich, they're powerful, they're living in the best part of town, and they have the world at their fingertips. We turn the page to Exodus 1. For us, it's a page turn. But in the pages of history, 400 years have transpired. In those 400 years, we only know one thing that happened. That one thing is this. There arose a Pharaoh who didn't remember Joseph. That's all we know. But when we open the book of Exodus, the children of Israel are now living as slaves. They're living in poverty. They have nothing. They're living a subsistence existence, and they're depending on the Egyptians just to keep them alive. My question is this, that one little phrase, there arose a Pharaoh that didn't remember Joseph, that doesn't tell us the whole story. My question is this, what happened? How did they go from the best set up, wealthiest people living in the best part of town, the most powerful people in the world, to now living as slaves, a subsistence existence in a land that's not even their own? And here's the thought that God dropped into my mind. Could it be that when God told the children of Israel through Moses, go get all of that stuff from the Egyptians, what he was really saying was this: I orchestrated Joseph's life to bring him from the promised land to Egypt because there were a lot of things in Egypt that I wanted my people to have. But through the process of time, all of that stuff that I orchestrated for you to have, you lost. You either traded it away, it was taken from you, you sold it, but now all of those things are gone. And before I take you back into the promised land, I want you to go get back all of that treasure that should have been yours by birthright. It should have been yours by birthright, but you lost it. And now I want you to go get it back before I take you back into the promised land. Now that's the background for the message that I want to preach. And here's the message that I want to preach to you tonight. You do not receive the Holy Ghost in a vacuum. What do I mean by that? When God fills you with His Spirit, He fills you with His Spirit in the real world. Do you know if you get the Holy Ghost tonight for the very first time, the alarm's still going to go off in the morning. You're still going to have to go to work. First of the month rolls around, you're still going to have to pay your bills. You're still going to have to deal with a boss that doesn't like you. You're still going to have to deal with kids that are going half crazy. You're still going to have to deal with neighbors who you're wondering what planet they're from. You're still going to have to deal with problems. You're still going to have to deal with situations and circumstances that don't seem to make sense. You're still going to have to deal with all of that junk. You know what we call all that stuff? Life. And when God gives you His Spirit, He gives you His Spirit right in the middle of your life. And so many of us look at the Holy Ghost as nothing more than our ticket to heaven. But the Holy Ghost is more than just your ticket out of here. Because if that's all the Holy Ghost was, when you got the Holy Ghost, you'd be gone. But we're still here. So when God fills you with His Spirit, He says, I see that you've still got this wilderness that we call life to traverse in front of you. You're still going to have to deal with situations. You're still going to have to deal with problems. You're still going to have to deal with all of this stuff that we call life. So when I give you my Spirit, I'm not just giving you a ticket out of here, but I'm going to give you everything that you need to make it through this thing that we call life. The Bible says when you're filled with the Spirit of God, He gives you peace. He gives you joy. He gives you victory. He gives you power. He gives you all of this other stuff. It just comes along with His Spirit. Have you ever seen somebody filled with the Holy Ghost? How do they act? They got a 10,000 watt smile on their face. They don't need a back door to get out of the church. They feel like they can just run through the wall. That's how it is when you get the Holy Ghost. They've got so much joy and excitement. You ask them how they're feeling, they don't even have the words to explain it. Have you ever tried to explain the Holy Ghost and how what it does for you? Just can't, there's no words to describe it. And when you were filled with the Holy Ghost, everybody in this place that's been filled with the Holy Ghost, when you got the Holy Ghost, you got all that stuff too. You got joy, you got peace, you got victory, you got power, you got all of this stuff. It came along with the Holy Ghost because God saw what you were going to need to make it through life. But then I've also noticed that through the process of time, something happens. Because I see a lot of people who have been living for God for a while, and I begin to ask myself the questions, what happened to that joy that they had? What happened to that peace? What happened to that victory? How come they're no longer walking in the power of the Holy Ghost? What happened to all of that stuff? And the story of Jacob and Esau comes to my mind. Esau had something that was of great value. He had a birthright. And he saw something that was going to give him temporary pleasure. He saw something that was just for the time being. And he traded away his most valuable thing for something that was only temporary. He traded away his birthright for a bowl of beans. And too often in the spirit, we come across circumstances and situations in our life and we don't realize the value of what we have in the spirit. And through the process of time, a little bit at a time, we'll trade away a little bit of our joy for this. We'll trade away a little bit of our peace. We'll trade away a little bit of our victory. We'll trade away a little bit of our power. We'll just begin to trade away little bits at a time, just incremental, until before long, before we even realize what's happened, we're living and we're living in despair and defeat. And we no longer have all of that stuff that we had when we were filled with the Spirit of God. We've lost it all. We've traded away. It was taken from us. I'm here with a message for you tonight and to tell you this. It doesn't have to be that way. Because I'm here with a message to tell you, you can get back those things that you once had in the spirit. See, we don't understand and realize what a treasure victory is until we're living in defeat. We don't realize what a treasure peace is until we can't lay our head down at night and get any rest. And we don't understand what a treasure power is until we're not walking in the power of God anymore. And we don't realize what a treasure all of those things are until we realize I don't have it anymore. Now, I'm not saying if the trumpet sounded, you wouldn't go. But I am saying this, there's too many Christians who are living a subsistence existence in their walk with God. You're living as slaves to your circumstances and to your situations. You come to church on a Sunday and you hope the pastor preaches the paint off the wall to give you just enough to make it to the next service. You're dependent upon the preached word of God just to help you survive from week to week. It doesn't have to be that way, and it shouldn't be that way. What happened to the power you were once walking in? What happened to the victory you were once living in? I'm here to tell you tonight, all of those things can be restored into your life. There's no reason for you to walk out the doors of this church empty tonight. But you can walk out full of the power of God. You can walk out full of the promises of God. You don't have to leave here the same way that you came in. But you can walk out of this place refreshed, renewed, and walking in a new power. Walking in a new anointing. Walking in a fresh victory. You don't have to walk out of this place the same way that you came in. What are the treasures that you need from God? I'm not talking about earthly treasure. What you have in your bank account, that doesn't really amount to a hill of beans. It can be gone tomorrow. The real treasures are the things that you get in the spirit, because those things can be eternal. The thing is, when you were born again, a lot of that stuff you got when you got the Holy Ghost, those things should be yours by birthright. But too often we give them away, we trade them away. It's time that we get back those things that should be ours. That love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, gentleness, meekness, faith. All of those things that it talks about in the Word of God, all of those gifts of the Spirit, all of those things that God gave us when He filled us with His Spirit. Those are the real treasures. What's the number one treasure you must have? The number one treasure you must have is a relationship with Him. Humanity was created to live in relationship with God. Philosopher put it this way. He said, inside of every man there is a God-shaped hole that is waiting to be filled. Adam and Eve were created to live in relationship with God, and every day they walked in the cool of the day with God. But because of sin, that relationship was broken. But because of the cross of Calvary, we now have the opportunity to once again enter into that relationship with Him. The number one thing that you must have is restored relationship with God. If you would like to experience that tonight, here's what you need to do. The Bible says that you must repent of your sins. What does that mean? It's a two-part process, repentance is. Number one is saying, God, I'm sorry for what I've done that's against you. And number two is, God, with your help, I'm not going to live that way anymore, but I'm going to do the very best I can to live according to your word. You must repent. Then the Bible says you must be baptized in the name of Jesus, where you invoke the name of Jesus over your life. If you have never been baptized in Jesus' name, the Bible says that's done for the remission of sins. It pays for your sins. It's through the blood of Jesus Christ. His blood is applied and the sins are paid for. If you have never been baptized in Jesus' name, you talk to your pastor. He would love to baptize you. And I would encourage you to do it tonight. Amen. And then the Bible says you can be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. It's used interchangeably in the text of the Bible. Sometimes it's called Holy Ghost, sometimes it's called Holy Spirit. They're the same exact thing. In the Greek, it's the same. It's the Hagios Pneuma. Same word. Sometimes they translate it Holy Ghost, sometimes Holy Spirit. But that's what I've been talking about tonight. When you receive the Holy Ghost, when you receive the Holy Spirit, that's when you receive all of this other stuff. If you've never received the Holy Ghost, there's no reason that you should leave this place tonight without experiencing the gift of the Holy Ghost. God wants to fill you with His Spirit. Now, I understand this is an apostolic Pentecostal church, and if you're a first-time guest here, I'm glad you're here, but you've probably heard strange things about us Pentecostals, speaking in tongues and all that sort of stuff. If you want to experience the gift of the Holy Ghost, here in just a couple of minutes, I'm going to open up these altars, and God wants to fill you with the Holy Ghost, but I want to give you some instructions. Number one, most important thing. When you come to this altar, don't come seeking speaking in tongues. Because you're not going to get the Holy Ghost that way. You come to the altar and you just pour yourself out to God and you seek Him. And when you get full of God, don't worry, you'll speak in tongues. That's the promise of the Bible. The book of James tells us that the tongue is the most unruly member. That means that what we say is the last thing that we want to give up control of. So it's no wonder that God chose speaking in tongues as the initial sign of the infilling of the Holy Ghost. So if you'll just come up here and totally surrender yourself to God, don't worry, you'll speak in tongues, but don't come seeking that. You seek God. And when you get God, all this other stuff will just come along with it. You'll speak in tongues. You'll get joy. You'll get peace. You'll get victory. You'll get power. You'll get all of this other stuff. And it's the most wonderful thing that you can experience. And God wants to fill you with His Spirit tonight. But I would surmise that a significant percentage and the majority of the people here tonight, you've already been filled with the Holy Ghost. My question is this, as you take stock of your walk with God, are you still walking in the same peace that you were walking in? Are you still walking in the same power? Are you still walking in the same joy? Are you still walking in the same victory? Or as you take stock of your Christian walk, have you noticed, I don't have some of those things that I once had? I'm here to tell you tonight, you can be restored into those things before you leave this place tonight. But just as it was in the book of Exodus, the same is true for us tonight. God left the responsibility up to the children of Israel to go get it. And tonight, the same is true. God is the ultimate gentleman. He is not going to force Himself on anybody. But if you have a need from God, if you need restored joy or peace or victory or power, whatever it may be, if you need the gift of the Holy Ghost, whatever it is, you are going to have to make a step of faith. You are going to have to go and get it. It's God who gives, but He's not going to force. Our good brother drummer, I don't know his name. He was just preaching about the Hall of Faith. KJ. Brother KJ. Excellent job. If you read through Hebrews chapter number 11, it talks about all the great people of faith. I pulled it up again after he was done, and I read through Hebrews 11 again. You know one thing that I notice about just about every single one of those people in Hebrews chapter number 11? Their faith led to action. By faith, Abraham left the land that he was from and went to the land of promise. By faith, Noah built an ark. By faith, so-and-so did this, and they did this, and they did this, and throughout the entire... See, there's become this misconception within the world today that faith is nothing more than mental assent. But anytime faith is talked about in the Word of God, it's accompanied by an action. Faith leads to action. And if you have the faith that God can restore, if you have the faith that God can fill, if you have the faith that God can touch, then that's going to lead to a response on your part. My faith that God is able will lead me to make a step of faith. I will respond when God moves. I will respond when His Spirit is calling. We like to think that something miraculous happened. I've got faith, so all of a sudden, poof, everything is great. Well, you don't have to believe me, but it's scriptural. I believe in the miraculous. I believe in the supernatural. But we have to make that step of faith. There's a reason it's called we have to make that move towards God. Because just as it was with the children of Israel, there were those who went and got what they needed from the Egyptians, but there was a significant percentage that never went and got what they should have got. And it's true tonight as well. There is a high probability that there are people who are going to be filled, who are going to be touched, who are going to be restored in this place tonight. But there is also a high probability that there are going to be people who get up and walk out of this place the exact same way that they came in. Because they're having the conversations in their mind just like the children of Israel did. And they're saying, preacher, what you're saying sounds good and it might work for so-and-so across the church. I know their situations, I know their problems, but that's just not going to work for me. You don't know my situation, you don't know my circumstance. And I will agree with you in as much as, and as far as this, that's true, I don't know you and I don't know your circumstance. But I do know God. And I will challenge you, if you will just make a step of faith, there's no telling what God may and can do and will do in your life. But you have to decide that you want it. Sometimes making a step of faith, it seems like a risky proposition, but you forget who your faith is in. My faith is in Him, so that takes a lot of the risk out of the situation. It seems risky in my own eyes. But do I forget that He is able to do all things? Let me just tell you a little bit about one of the... I've mentioned it several times. One of the things that God gives us when He fills us with His Spirit is He gives us peace. And this is something that God has been really dealing with me about. Do we understand what the peace of God really is? Do you have any idea of what that entails? When you study what peace is in a biblical context, the word peace comes from the Hebrew word shalom. When you study what shalom is in the biblical text, the word shalom means completeness or wholeness. When we talk about peace between nations, what that means is their relationship is complete and whole. There's no fracturing or breaking in the relationship between those countries. Jesus was talking to his disciples in John chapter number 14. He said, I'm getting ready to leave, but when I leave, I'm going to send my comforter back to you. The word comforter there is the Greek word parakletos. It means the one who comes alongside. Some translations translate it as our advocate. He said, I'm going to send that to you. It'll be my spirit. And then he said, let not your hearts be troubled. He said, my peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. It's a peace that the world doesn't understand. My peace I give unto you. Did you catch what just happened there? My peace I give to you. How is it that somebody who has been filled with the Spirit can have peace when their world is turned upside down? How come somebody who has been filled with the Spirit, even when they've lost their job and they don't know how they're going to pay their next bill, even when it seems like everything is turned upside down, they can still have peace? How is that even possible? It doesn't make sense to the world. It's a peace that the world doesn't understand. But Jesus said, when I leave you with my Spirit, when I send the Comforter to you, he said, my peace I give unto you. What he was saying was, my completeness or wholeness, the entirety of who I am, I'm going to leave with you. So when you get the Spirit of God, you get the completeness and wholeness of God residing inside of you. So it's not my circumstances that dictate how I'm going to react. It's not my circumstances or situation, because it's not my peace. It's the peace of God. It's his completeness or whole. It's not dependent on how broken my world may seem or how messed up everything in my life is, but I've got the entirety of God, his peace dwelling inside of me. That's how come I can have peace even when the world is turned upside down, because I've got his peace inside of me. That's what his Spirit gives to me. So you can have that peace. You can have that joy. You can have that victory. You can have that power. But I got to make this step of faith that says, God, I need that back in my life. I at one time had it, but somehow or other, through the process of time, I've lost it. But God, I'm ready to get it back. I've made up in my mind, I don't want to leave tonight without getting what I need from your presence. Jacob was on the run for his life. And he laid down and was using a stone as a pillow. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him. And Jacob said, wait a minute, I can't let this opportunity pass me by. And he began to wrestle with that angel. And the angel said, let me go. Jacob said, wait a minute, there's something that I need. I'm not going to be satisfied to leave here the same way that I came here. He said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. I'm not going to let you go until I get what I need from you. And before he left, the angel of the Lord touched the hollow of his thigh and changed his name. He was no longer deceiver, but he became a prince with God. There's something that happens when we come into the presence of God and we get that bulldog determination that says, God, I'm not going to be satisfied to leave here the same way that I came in. I need the very identity of who I am to be changed. I need my identity to be lost and my new identity to be found in you. That's what can happen in the presence of God. But you have to make the determination that says, this is something that I need. I'm not going to be satisfied until I experience it. And I'm here to tell you, that's going to happen in just a few moments in this place tonight. How is it going to happen? We often have this preconceived notion of how God is supposed to work. We're Pentecostal. We think it's going to happen because we're all swinging from the ceiling fans. I love that. It's great. But sometimes I think we limit what God can do by how we think he's supposed to move. I've closed my Bible. I'm just about done. If we'll just take the limits off of what we think God can do and how he's supposed to do it, God's going to show up in a mighty way here tonight. Let me give you an example. I was preaching a crusade overseas, and this was an outdoor crusade, and I had just preached, and a fellow minister was doing the altar call. We're Pentecostal. We got away. We think we're supposed to do altar calls. We didn't do it anything like you're supposed to do it. I don't apologize for that. We didn't do it that way this time. We got ready to do the altar call, and here's what we did. We went and lined up about 40 or 50 chairs facing the platform. We said, if you need the Holy Ghost, come sit in a chair. Well, people started coming up and sitting in the chairs, and all the chairs got filled up, and before long, people started lining up behind the chairs. The minister doing the altar call was giving instructions on repentance and things like that. I was giving instructions to altar workers over on the side. And then the minister said this. He said, now I'm going to speak the word of faith, and when I speak the word of faith, these altar workers are going to lay hands on you, and God is going to fill you with the Holy Ghost. Simple. Sometimes we make our dealings with God so complicated when the gospel is really pretty simple. It's just simple. He said, we're going to lay hands on you when I speak the word of faith, and God's going to fill you with the Holy Ghost. Simple. So he said, now by the power and the authority of the word of God, receive ye the Holy Ghost. We began to lay hands on people, and immediately people started getting filled with the Holy Ghost. When they would get the Holy Ghost, we would send them up to the platform to get their name and information and connect them with a pastor from their area. We want to connect people to their local church. And then we'd have somebody else sit in their chair, and we'd pray for them. They'd get the Holy Ghost. Send them up to the platform. Well, if you've ever prayed with people in the altar, you know that can be exhausting work, especially when it's outside and it's hot. After a while, I was getting tired. I called reinforcements. I said, you come pray with my chair. I'm going to go drink a bottle of water. I'll be back in a few minutes. So I went over, and I was standing on the sidewalk that was overlooking this plaza area where we were having this crusade. And as I was standing there drinking a bottle of water, a man came up, started to talk to me, and he said, what's going on over there? I said, we just had church. People are getting the Holy Ghost. He goes, oh, okay. Well, my faith was pretty high. I had just seen a lot of people get the Holy Ghost. So I was just kind of crazy. I said, do you want the Holy Ghost? Now, pastor, it's not supposed to work that way. He wasn't there for church. He didn't hear the altar call. I didn't even take him to the altar area. We were standing on the sidewalk drinking a bottle of water. It's not supposed to work that way. I said, would you like to receive the Holy Ghost? He gave me a really faith-building response. He said, sure, why not? That'll just build your faith. Sure, why not? So I explained to him what repentance was. He repented. And I said, now just lift your hands and begin to worship God. I'm going to lay hands on you, and God's going to fill you with the Holy Ghost. He said, okay. He lifted his hands. He began to worship God. I laid hands on him, and within just a few moments, he began speaking in tongues. Before we left that afternoon, 256 people had been filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. It doesn't have to be hard. It doesn't have to happen the way that we think it should. But if we'll just take the limits off of our imagination, there's no telling what God is going to do in this place tonight. God is going to fill people. God is going to deliver people. God is going to heal people. God is going to restore people, because that's what God does. When we make a step of faith towards Him, when we open ourselves up to Him, God shows up and God shows out. That's what He does. And God is in this place tonight, and God is about to work the miraculous in people's lives. We're about to step into the realm of the supernatural and the miraculous. Will you just let your faith rise in this place right now, in Jesus' name? Lord, right now I feel your spirit. I feel your power. Lord, you are about to show up in this place. You are about to transform lives. You are about to transform hearts. You're about to change destinies in this place. Lord, right now I pray that you would give us the courage to make a step of faith. God, I pray that you would give us the courage right now to respond to the moving of your spirit and just see what you will do in this place. Lord, right now I pray that you would show up and that you would show out in this place so that we can see the miraculous, so that we can see the supernatural, and so that we can see your glory made manifest in this place tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, let it be done. In Jesus' name I pray. All right. I'm not going to make some big elaborate altar call. This is it. This is your opportunity. If you have a need, whatever it may be, if you need deliverance, if you need healing, if you need the Holy Ghost, if you need a restoration in your life, whatever it is that you may need, would you make a step of faith right now and just see if God will show up? Would you do that tonight? There are people coming from all over as the musicians begin to play and sing. God is going to show up and he is going to touch people's lives in this place tonight. Would you come by faith? Now, right now, all over this place, would you just lift your hands and begin to worship God? And God is going to begin to fall. The Spirit of God is going to begin to fall in this place. And God is going to touch people's hearts in this place tonight. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let your spirit be poured out in this place. Let your glory fall in this place tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
It's coming our way.
Yes, Jesus.
It's the season of power.
In Jesus' name.
Prosperity.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Coming to me.
The Holy Ghost power is here in this place.
It's a new season.
Would you just respond to him tonight? He wants to restore you. He wants to touch you. He wants to fill you. Don't leave this place empty tonight, but leave full of the power of God. Leave full of a fresh anointing. Leave full of a fresh touch of God.
Hallelujah. It's a new season. It's a new season. It's a new season coming to me.
Say no limits,
no limits,
no boundaries,
no boundaries.
I see increase,
I see increase.
All around,
all around.
It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Say no limits,
no limits,
no boundaries,
no boundaries.
I see increase,
I see increase.
All around,
all around.
It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Hey, no limits,
no limits,
no boundaries,
no boundaries.
I see it,
I see it,
all around,
all around.
It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Give him praise all over this auditorium. God's presence is rich. Let the Holy Ghost flow. God has been speaking to the church today, both services, very strongly on this issue about faith and how to move forward in faith. How many of you appreciate the word of God that's been in the house today? God's talking to us. There's numbers of people that are still praying and people being touched. But I want to say this, because I know some are going to need to leave here in a few. But I want to be a blessing to Brother and Sister Buckland. We're going to give an offering out of our missions account as we normally would. However, I feel like we ought to give toward that airline project and just try to be an extra help to them. They're leaving early in the morning, heading all the way to Indiana, then down to St. Louis. If you're able to have an extra missions offering tonight, I'm asking you to come to the side here and leave it up on top of the pulpit as we do, and we'll take that and process it and pass it on to our missionaries. If you need to go tonight, you're dismissed in the name of the Lord, and we thank you for being faithful to the house of the Lord today. But if you have a missionary offering, come and bring it and leave it on the pulpit, and let's be a blessing in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's it. Thank you. You're being a blessing to the missionary. Bless one another. Let the Holy Ghost just flow and minister.